How are you? Welcome again, and it's more American cooking. This time, the barbecue. I bet you didn't know that barbecue was terribly American, but it is. The term barbecue is actually a French word, and there are some interesting theories as to what it means, but it's been with our culture since the very, very beginning, so I'm claiming it today because we barbecue like no one in the world. The term barbecue comes from the word barb, which means beard, this one, you see, to queue. You know, in England you say queue up, get in line. It means tail. So it literally means, barbecue literally means from your beard to your tail. That is to say, you put a stick at an animal and roast him over a pit, from beard to tail. Obviously it was referring to a goat. I think so. Well, in any case, that's the background of the term. And it was used commonly in America as early as the early 1700s and began occurring in cookbooks. When our cookbooks were first published, you see, about 1790, the term barbecue was used. So it's not a new thing. I thought it was new because my Uncle Vic taught me to barbecue when I was a little kid, and he always had the very first of everything. You remember, I've told you about him. He's my Lebanese uncle. And he had a barbecue. He made barbecued chicken for me when I was about 7. I'd never heard of the term. No one else had either. And oh, it was just delicious, just delicious. All right, what can I tell you about barbecue? First of all, the first major problem with American barbecuing is that we get the fire too hot. The term barbecue really prefers to refer to very slow cooking. Not this intense heat with a lot of charcoal close to a piece of meat, and you throw the meat on and it climbs out of the pan. You throw it back and the fire climbs out again. That's too hot. It refers to slow cooking. Do you know that in Texas you can be thrown in jail for cooking spare ribs too fast? I know a gal who knows how to cook them properly. Her name is Edith, and Edith runs the most wonderful place. It's on Clybourne Street here in Chicago. And when Edith puts in the fire, you see, it's just hickory wood down on the bottom, and then she puts the ribs in the top. Notice there is no sauce. And this is done right in the middle of the dining room. It's not the kind of place that you take your mother-in-law the first night because there are no tablecloths. It's for Micah, and this is gorgeous Edith. Watch this. Look, she takes the ribs out of the fire and dips them in the sauce and then gives them to me. Wonderful food. The point I'm making about Edith is that she cooks those ribs very, very slowly over very, very light heat. That's just absolutely important to what we're trying to talk about today. That's the meaning of really fine, fine barbecue. Smoke it slow over wood and don't put the sauce on until after the dish is finished. Now that's what I've done for you today. First of all, let me finish with some other problems. One other problem, and the other big, big problem. One, the fire's too hot, and two, Americans use disgusting fire starters. We use such things as gasoline, benzene, petrol, kerosene, ouzo, anything you could get your hands on that's going to cause a flame, and they leave terrible odors in the charcoal. Please don't do that. Let me show you something. Find a number 10 tin. See one of these? Here's what we have. This is a 10 tin, number 10 can. Take a, a church key can opener, you see, and open this up on the bottom and on the sides so that you have all kinds of holes in this. Set it on a rack so that it can get air underneath. You want a little wire rack. Then, this is what you do. You know, if you make one of these out of a 10 tin, which is free, you will save about, I think they're about $15 if you buy one professionally made. What is a professional fire starter? Pyromaniac, that's what he is. Put some paper in the bottom, put in a little bit of cheap kindling, some twiggies, you see, and then throw in a few briquettes and light it through a hole in the bottom with a wooden match. It'll be going in nothing flat, your briquettes are going, and you do not have the odor of a burning fire station. You simply don't need it. That's awful. Now, what are the possibilities in terms of wood? Well, you can get all kinds of crazy things. The old rage, of course, was using hickory. Here's hickory. In our part of this is the hickory, see. In our part of the woods, in Seattle, Tacoma, the West Coast, we use alder. The Northwest Indians smoke salmon over alder. Oh, it's heaven. And, of course, here is the inwood. The inwood being, of course, mesquite. I think mesquite has a very sharp, just a terribly sharp flavor. I don't like it. I don't care if it is the rage in California. It smells too much like a house that's on fire. You know what I mean? Another one that people use is oak. Down south, you'll find them using any kind of hardwood, and oak is common, so you have a little hickory and a little oak. But I tried cooking with oak, and it smelled like I had roasted the pork over my grandmother's antique table, you know, burned up the table too. Ugh, I don't like it. I don't need the smell that way. What you do with big chunks of wood is, of course, soak them in water and then just set them on top of the charcoal. And then you're on your way. All right. Now, I have for you in a Kamado oven, because we're going to talk about a basic principle. Remember, don't have the fire too hot. Here's a solution. This oven, my pot fork here, this oven is very, very interesting. It is called a Kamado, and it was originally made in China, and then it went to Japan, and it came from Japan for years, and now it's being made in China again. We're talking 1,000 years old. And then it became big time in Japan, and they sold them like crazy, and now they're too expensive. Everything from Japan is becoming expensive. So the Chinese are making them again. This one came from Taiwan. It is called a Kamado, which is a Japanese name. And I'm going to get some letters from some of you who are Japanese. It is a Kamado by name, but its invention, I know, is Chinese. Was Chinese, will be Chinese. This is what happens. There's a pot at the bottom of this thing where you put the fire. You see, the charcoal is way, way down here. Here's a little vent, you see? The charcoal goes in the bottom so that this distance from here to here is made before you come to the grill. That means that the meat is not dried out, which is very, very important. And in most American cookers, the smoke is wonderful. In most American cookers, of course, the meat is too close to the fire, and you have real trouble. So try a Kamado. It's going to cost you about $200 for one of these things. And that sounds like an awful lot of money, but it's a glorious thing to play with, just absolutely glorious. I have a pork shoulder here and, of course, some ribs. And these ribs have been cooked slowly. I'm going to leave a couple in there and let them go. You're wondering about why I'm doing all this cooking actually in my kitchen. No. I hauled this in from the patio. You can't do this in your house. I'm the only madman in the neighborhood that would do such a thing. You don't want to do that. You want to put it out in the patio because the smoke is terrible. And if you do smoke in the house with little bitty smokers, then be sure that you use a good vent. Now, the other thing that we do in American cooking is to put the charcoal in something like this. This is a much I would call closer cooker. You see, you know what this is. You see, this is a Weber, and it's a good one. But the point is that it's so close to the meat that you're going to dry out the meat. And I don't want you to do that. I want it moist and slow. Remember, that's the word. And remember, you go to jail if you cook the ribs too fast. All right. Now, I have some spare ribs for you. Let me get these on a platter. The kind of thing that Edith was cooking. But you remember, Edith doesn't put the sauce on the ribs until after. Whoops, excuse me. Let me get my pot fork here. There we are. Edith doesn't put the... Oh, come on, you. Just come on. Get over here. Doesn't put the sauce in the ribs until after she's ready to serve. And you remember, she just grabbed the old barbecue sauce. I'm going to slop mine on with a brush. But Edith was using a big pot full of sauce, and she just used a clamp and just dipped it inside. All right, first thing, barbecued ribs, if you'll pardon me, made properly. At least that's how I've been taught by some fine old black chefs. There. Now, the second thing I want to show you, a very unusual dish. This is a piece of pork shoulder. Let me show you what I started with. The shoulder itself, when you begin, looks something like this, you see? This is about 4 pounds, and it has one bone in the center. You put it into a Kamado, and you smoke it slow. And by smoking, I mean you put in the bottom of the Kamado a bit of a wood. Sometimes you can use sawdust. My brother Greg has a big bunch of alder trees on his property in Whidbey Island. He'll grind up. You know what I mean? You run them through these thrashing machines. He'll grind up alder for me, and I have a wonderful batch of alder sawdust, and I simply wet that and then sprinkle it on the charcoal. Does two things. One, it keeps the fire cool, right? And secondly, it provides with wonderful smoke. Now, when you go down south to places like South Carolina, look at this. You see what's happening? Now, we're talking slow cooking. I just have to yell at this bone, and he comes right out. Get out of there. See? What'd I tell you? All right. What you do down south is to tear this meat up with a sort of fork affair, and they immediately put it in a... Let me get a bowl for you so I can show you how this is done. I've never seen anything like this. In Greensboro, North Carolina, forgive me, I didn't say it twice, I'm sorry. Greensboro, North Carolina, this is what they do. They put the meat in a bowl and they add vinegar, they just tear it up like this. So you just kind of tear it up into shreds. And they add a bit of pepper and a bit of vinegar, and I think that's it. I mean, ouch. I was disappointed. Oh boy, am I going to get a letter from you guys. We went to 5 different places, and they were all basically the same. Much too much vinegar for me, and a lot of pepper. The pepper was nice, but what I want to do is to show you how they do it in Richmond, Virginia. You barbecue the shoulder over any kind of wood you can get your hand on. Old wood, you see. Hardwood, I mean. And then, rather than just using vinegar, excuse me while I have a little cleanup job here, rather than using just vinegar for the dish, they mix the barbecue sauce right into the meat. There's no bone. You eat this on a piece of white bread. You wear a baseball cap. Oh, that's the truth. And it's wonderful eating. So I'm just going to put some barbecue sauce into the bowl. We'll mix that up, put it on a platter, and we're ready to serve food that is just terrific. Very different. If you've not had this kind of barbecue, oh, it's good. There are some marvelous places in downtown Richmond. Richmond, Virginia is one of my favorite cities. Stay at the, I can't remember the name of the hotel. The square, the common square. Common house, common wheel, common something. It's right across the street from the Capitol building, which was designed by my good friend, Tom Jefferson. A wonderful place to stay, and you can have barbecue that will just cause you to weep. All right. Looks a little bit different if you're California or Texas style and you assume that barbecue is always going to be on the bone. No, not this way. See how moist the meat is? It just falls apart when you yell at it. Oh, this is good. All right. Second dish out to go. And remember, the sauce was put on last, you see? Barbecue, North Carolina or Virginia style. Now, thirdly, what do I have for you thirdly? I'm dying to see. Oh, this was from my old days at Drew University. When I was in graduate school, my wife and I decided that we would learn to barbecue because it was a good way to entertain, and we really couldn't afford good cuts of meat. Here's a good recipe. Very, very simple. You take a pot roast. Here we go. Here's a pot roast. I need to get a little bit of water here first. You always forget something when you're trying to explain a recipe. Are you tired of people who tell you they've given you the whole recipe and they cheat on one ingredient? Cut their heads off. All right, here we go. Take a pot roast. This is not expensive meat. And it has very good flavor, though it's one of the tougher cuts. So poke holes in it with a pot fork, or any kind of fork you want. You know, I'm just using my old pot fork. And into that, onto the meat, I should say. I'm going to put a little bit of meat tenderizer. Now, you've never seen me do this, but this is what we used to do at Drew. That's in New Jersey. Now, this has no salt in it. It's unsalted. I don't want you using a lot of salt in your food. You don't need that. Then we'll put just a tad of water on this. There, and rub it in. That will rub in the... Let it marinate now for a while. That will allow the tenderizing agents to sink into the meat. And don't start in on me about chemicals on a meat tenderizer. What you have in a meat tenderizer is a product called papain. Is that how you say it? Papain? Well, anyhow, it comes from the papaya plant. And what it's doing is sort of, I might as well say it, it's kind of partially digesting the meat. It's an enzyme that begins to break down the fibers of the meat. And it's perfectly all right. It's a normal food product. It's not a chemical in the normal sense. So you don't have to be nervous about that. No salt in this. All right, onto a platter. What I'm going to do now is to add a bit of, let's see, here we go, a bit of kitchen bouquet, the caramel, little caramel flavoring and caramel color. Just pour some on, not a lot, but just a little bit. What do I have? A couple tablespoons. Some soy sauce. I'm using light soy. That doesn't mean it's light in salt. It means that it's lighter than, well, you can see that it has very little caramel in it. You see what I'm... Normally, soy sauce would leave a lot of mud on the side of the bottle. You see? It has no extract in it, of extract of sugar. Very light. Okay. And thirdly, I want some Coleman's English mustard. I don't need any salt on this, but oh boy, do I need pepper. Pepper's what does it. I love pepper. There we go. I'm going to do this on both sides. This is the part that Channing used to love when he was a little kid. You know, the only bad thing with feeding your children well is that it makes them get taller and taller and they grow up. If there's some way I could have stopped that process, I think I would have stopped them at about 5 years old. Funny? Kid was a wild, well, he's still a kick, but I would do this and he would say, okay, Dad, step back. And he would do the rubbing. He thought this was the fun part. I can't understand. Yes, I can. Oh, he said, right. Well, I'd turn it over then and do the same on the other side. Now, let me rinse my hand off, and I want to slice some onions that go on the top of this, and we'll have a roast. Actually, this is not my recipe at all. It was given me by Dr. Lester Baskin, my dear friend, to whom we dedicated our very first cookbook a long time ago. Now, you do that on both sides, right? And then I'm going to whack up an onion here and simply sprinkle it on the top. There we go. And this would go into your barbecue, and you could you're a charcoal cooker, and you could do it any way you like. And you're saying, well, wait a minute, why do you use the word barbecue when you haven't put this meat on a stick from beard to tail? I don't know. That's no, that's just what we call it in our time. But originally, of course, it meant that you were cooking the meat over a large fire, and that implied that you were using a large piece of meat. In our time, we use smaller ones. In Greece, on Easter, they roast whole lambs everywhere in town. Oh, it's fun. So beautiful. We'll set this aside and cook it in a minute. I'll put it in the cooker in a moment because I have another thing I want to show you. A couple more things I want to show you. Here's another one. Terribly simple, and we're talking delicious. Two chicken halves. Two chicken halves, one chicken cut in half, right? Into a bowl. To this, we're going to add a bit of garlic. Aha, now you know which channel you're watching, right? Okay, a little bit of garlic. What have I got? Oh, about three or four cloves. And we want to add some olive oil. Just pour it right in there. Don't ask me how much. All right, 2 1/8 tablespoons. I'm getting snippy with you, I'm sorry. And some Marsala, about the same amount. This is dry Marsala, dry Italian Marsala wine. Wonderful stuff. And some rosemary. Now, I prefer that you use fresh rosemary. But if you don't have fresh rosemary, and I don't today, then just use the dried needle. But do it whole. Don't use the ground-up stuff. What have I forgotten? One ingredient. Is it a little salt? No, I don't want salt. Pepper and lemon. That's what's going to avoid our use of salt. I should have remembered that. Sorry about that. Get a lemon here. We'll put in the juice of about half a lemon. And my old lemon reamer. Let's do it, huh? There we go. And some pepper. All natural food. You don't want all that stuff. You just don't need all the chemicals that we have in our food. There we go. Much pepper as you like. And that will be rolled about. Just mix it all up. This is the good part. I can hear Channing again. Hold it, Dad. Hold it. You'll blow that. You'll mess it up. Let me do it. I can hear him in there laughing and talking to the chicken. We've always talked to the chickens in our house. Okay, this will also go in the oven, in the barbecue oven. Let me rinse my hands off, and I'll show you one more. This one came from a friend. Every once in a while, I'm able to go to have dinner with someone. They invite me out to interesting places outside of the city when I'm here in town working. So I live in Seattle and Tacoma. But every once in a while, I'm here in town taping shows and talking with you. I get an invitation to some place for dinner. Well, this guy had a barbecue set up I couldn't believe. Everything was delicious, but this dish, the whole concept really, really threw me, really impressed me. Zucchini, cut off the top and the bottom. And quarter the rascal, right? Do the same thing with a potato that you've partially baked. Let me get these on a platter so you can understand what I'm trying to do here. You've partially baked a potato. These are raw. Don't misunderstand me now. These are raw. And I have a potato here that I've cut up. And you said, it's still firm. It's as if you'd cooked him for a potato salad. You know what I mean? Not so that he's soggy. I don't want that. And on top of that, where did I put the dressing? Here we go. On top of that, you're going to brush a very good olive oil and vinegar dressing, or a vinaigrette. This one is interesting. I did not make this one. One of my young friends that helps me cook before you come each day whipped this up for me, and I tasted it. I said, good Lord, there's something strange in here. I said, what is it? And he smirked, and he said, fresh ginger. Try that. Put a little fresh ginger in your normal garlic and oil dressing. Whew, we're talking yummy. All right, now let me put this in an oven. I've got another kind of oven to show you. We've already talked about two. Do you remember? The Kamado and then the regular standard backyard. Well, this one is a kick. It's a product of, who puts it out? What says in the front? It says Weber. I guess I can figure that out. Yeah, that's not too complex, is it? My pot fork is here. Now, in my Weber, this is a gas affair, and it works very, very well. Wow. Here's everything we need. I have cooked the pot roast that I told you about. Let me see if I can get this onto a plate without breaking my arm. Good heavens. All right. And we'll add to that two chicken halves. And these are the ones with the rosemary. Remember? Ooh, I've got to set this down. My arm's hurting. And I have a whole batch of vegetables that we've cooked up. I'm just going to slide them on here. Potatoes, and of course, the zucchini. And I also have a batch of shrimp that I put on a stick. Isn't that a kick? Just put them on a stick. And you can throw them in your smoker, or let them smoke along with the vegetables and the chicken. Don't cook them long, just a couple of minutes, please. Let's get serious here. Whoops, that one we're gonna lose, okay. This is wonderful because it's adjustable heat, and you can just take it about anywhere in the house. All right, here's some vegetables that we've put in our barbecue with some salad dressing. Pre-cook the potatoes, but not the zucchini. Never the zucchini. And think of some other things you might want to do. If you pre-cook a carrot and slice them in long sticks, brush them with salad dressing, then heat them up at the last minute. Terrific! You should be able to open your barbecue and take out all kinds of good things. So here's the pot roast and the chicken. Now, today's new special gimmick. I have a gadget. This is the first time I've used it, and I'm very, very impressed. What I have, let me find a plate. Here we go. Platter big enough to receive this. This is the most interesting piece of equipment. I just received this. What does it say? Cameron's. Cameron's made this. And it has a device, you see, that provides a handle, but it'll close up. You see how this goes? You see how this works? Provides you with a handle, but this will close up and stay in one piece in your cabinet. Now watch this. Look what's inside. Look what's inside. It's a screen. I have inside of this three fresh trout. And as I take this apart, you will understand what this, he calls it a smoker, and you'll see what this does. The trout are sitting on a rack. Let's take them out. And beneath the trout, there is a drip pan. You see this? And beneath the drip pan is a spot for you to put some sawdust of any kind of wood you like. He'll even sell you the sawdust. The thing just works great. I don't plug anybody, but I'm cracking up over this one. You see how ingenious that is? The sawdust goes in the bottom. Put that on a normal burner, electric or gas. You can even put it outside on your barbecue if you want to smoke while you're cooking something else. Then the drip pan goes in. And then the rack on which the food goes so that the dripping food doesn't put out the sawdust, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Do you understand what I'm saying? And the lid goes on the top. It's a marvelous gadget. Okay, let me get the salmon. Why do I keep calling them salmon? Because I'm from Seattle, Tacoma, that's why. And we eat salmon, but these are lake-grown trout that I just bought at the market, and they're just beautiful. And smoked, oh, and no problem. I just put them in there, cook them for about 15 or 20 minutes on medium heat, you know, when it began to smoke, and we're done. One other thing we need to have a proper barbecue, and that, of course, is a first-class salad. And you have a meal. I wouldn't invite the Queen of England in. I don't know that she likes barbecue, but I'd certainly invite in everybody else. That's the nature of good barbecue. It is an American concept because we claimed it in the South, we claimed it in Texas, and we've actually been doing it since the time of the colonies. So today, I've cooked for you barbecued spare ribs, slow, 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 slow. Remember the jail charge. I've also cooked a big pork shoulder roast in the style of Virginia or North Carolina, and you'll rip it up and put on the sauce later. We cook some vegetables and shrimp on a stick. Not ice cream, but shrimp on a stick. We cook some chickens with rosemary and marsala, and a pot roast, according to Uncle Lester Baskin, with a bit of mustard and soy sauce on it. Wonderful. And finally, we smoked some trout. We did nothing more. We didn't even put salt on it. We simply put it in the pan. Well, I think this was hickory sawdust, and we smoked it. And when those are cold, I know you can eat them warm and enjoy them, but when those are cold, with a little bit of mayonnaise and a light green salad and a glass of Chablis and someone you love, whew, we're talking eating. That's what we do. I'm glad that we could celebrate the meaning of the American barbecue. Until I see you again, cook well and have a good time. This is the Frugal Gourmet. I bid you peace. Bye-bye.